Amen. You have a seat if you want. All the papers that are in front of you, for those that have grabbed it and read it, you should have never done it. Did anybody tell you to do it? Isn't that interesting? Isn't it interesting that we take it upon ourselves to find out what's going on? Hallelujah. We're going to be using that a little bit later on today. Hallelujah. Penny and I were grandson and I, we spent time last night doing some posters for you today. Amen. Hallelujah. I told you, we ain't going to stop on this thing. I get the other leg there. Because I tell you, it's powerful, folks. Today we're going to take a little spin. Little spin off of some of the things, because when we start to understand, because I'll tell you right now, even though we've been going through this, let me tell you, I remember many, many years ago, a pastor spoke to me and told me one of the things. He said, when God gives you revelation knowledge, it may take 3 years before your congregation gets it. Amen. That's how long it may take. See, you got it. Just as Dee was sitting there, she said, oh man, you got to read this, Because see, everybody's at different levels. Everybody's in different places in their lives. So what happens is, it would be great if we were all on the same level, man. You want to talk about some power. But that's what God wants. God wants us to get in that place where we're all in one accord. Because if we're not in one accord, what happens, the enemy comes in and starts to do a bunch of junk, as we talked about in Ephesians chapter 4 last week. We're just going to go over that just a little bit, and then we're going to touch. I'm going to talk to you today. I'm going to take a few other scriptures out of, not in Ephesians, as in other places, in 1 John, in Corinthians. And we're going to look at what other writers are saying and apply it to what is up here. And you will see that this up here is a key to opening some things in heaven. It's a key, folks. And when you get it, when we get it, I'm not saying that you're not getting it. What I'm saying is, when we come to the understanding, I'm already seeing testimonies and testimonies and testimonies. People are telling me about, oh man, this isn't happening anymore. This isn't happening. I'm changing my attitude. I'm changing my prayer life. I'm changing this. Because it's a key, folks. Amen. It's a key.
Hallelujah.
Amen? So I have up front here, overflowing love. We love because he first loved us in 1 John 4:19. And we're gonna get to that in a little bit. But let's go back right now and go back into Ephesians chapter 4. In Ephesians chapter 4, we're going to read from verse 4, chapter 4, verse 3 to 6. We were talking about this last week. Remember, Paul is talking from chapter 1 all the way to chapter 4. He's teaching us understanding how to get this key. And it's not just telling us a key, but then he continues to go on. And he says, there's a reason why you need this key. There's a reason why you need this key. This key is not just for yourself, but it's also for the body of Christ. The body of Christ. And in verse 3, chapter 4, Ephesians, verse 3, it says, endeavoring to keep and to keep the unity of the Spirit in bond of peace. Endeavoring, that means actively pursuing.
Amen.
Actively pursuing. Listen, actively doing. Actively doing. That word keep means to guard. That means actively guarding. Guarding. Why? Because the enemy is seeking whom he may devour. He's looking around. You know, we've talked about it before. When you look at some of the natural geographic things, and you see all the wildebeest out there, and there's maybe thousands and thousands of them. And that lion, he's sneaking up. And what's he looking for? He's not looking for the strong one. He's looking for the weak one. He's looking for the one that maybe is faltering a little bit. That's who he goes after. And see, what happens is you understand, when you understand the key, you won't be a weak one. Come on now.
Yes.
You'll be a strong one.
Yes.
And so that means that, guess what? You're going to have less, you'll be less likely to fall on the tactics of the enemy. I want everybody to be, I pray for myself, that I become so strong that the enemy just, he looks at me and I could be like a hyena and go, amen?
Amen?
Not laugh at him, because I'll tell you one thing, that's stupid. Come on now. You can get to the point where all of a sudden you think you're so brave and you're so good that all of a sudden the enemy can't mess with you. And he will. He'll find that little button. And that little button is this. That little button is that flesh.
Amen.
He'll find that button. And he'll encourage you. He'll say, oh, hey, have you ever thought about this?
Right.
Hey, he may not tell you something that's contrary to the word of God. Listen to me. But what he may do is get you off guard in what God's got you.
Mm-hmm.
See, God's got you going in a direction. Then all of a sudden he'll say, hey, what about this? Hey, what about this? Hey, you know what? That's a good idea. Listen, and then you start getting off track.
Amen.
And then as soon as you get off track, what happens is you're setting yourself up for a problem.
Amen.
Setting yourself up for a problem. In verse 4 it says, and there is one body. How many?
One.
There's one spirit. How many?
One.
Amen.
Amen.
Even as you are called into one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all, through all, and in you all.
Yes. Amen.
There's only one. There's only one Spirit. There's only one Jesus.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
Oh, I can get to heaven a lot of different ways. No, you can't. You can only get through Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus is the only, as the Bible says, no man can come to the Father but through me.
That's right.
But through me. And as Paul was talking to the church of Ephesus, and he's saying this, he's reminding them, he says, when you got the key, remember, you're going to have the enemy out there who's going to teach you to do this. He's going to try to pull you away from what you know. Pull you away from what you believe. Pull you away from your faith. We're going to skip down to verse 11. There's a lot of different things in here, and I don't want to get off track of what the Lord is leading us in. Amen?
Amen.
In verse 11 it says, and he gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. For what? For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Notice it doesn't say for praying for you for your new house. Praying for you for your new car. He said, a pastor, an apostle, and a teacher is not there to provide for your needs. He's there to provide for your spiritual need.
Amen.
Your spiritual need. You would be surprised at how many people do not come to me and ask me spiritual questions. I'm being real.
Amen.
Amen. But how can we do this? How can we do this? How can we do this? And I'm always looking for somebody to come and say, hey, Pastor, you know, could you explain this thing to me? I'll be more than happy to sit down and talk to you about the Word of God. But see, we get so carried away, again, back to the outer man. The outer man wants to be pleased. The outer man wants to be pleased. Well, you know, somebody may come and say, you know what, they're about ready to turn my electric off. All right, I'll share this, because what happens is sometimes I'll go to somebody and I'll say, well, let me ask you a question. Do you have cable? Yeah, I got all the channels. What kind of phone you got? Oh, I got the top one. I got an iPhone, blah, 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 that does all this stuff. I've got this. I said, what you need to do is get rid of all that so you can pay your bills. Well, that means you're not going to help me out. Silver and gold have I not, but that what I have I can give to you.
Amen.
See, sometimes you got to be real with people. Sometimes you got to understand. Sometimes somebody may look at us and say, you know what? The bottom line's up here is most important thing in anybody in this room is not your outer man, but your inner man.
Amen.
He is the one, when you strengthen him, when he is strong, just like up front, you may look like that, and you may think you're all fit, but let me tell you, your inner man is a lot stronger than you think he is.
Amen.
But you got to build him up.
Yeah.
How do you build him up? You don't build him up by just coming to church on Sunday morning. You don't build him up by just listening to somebody on the TV, some evangelist, because I'm going to tell you right now, if you're not rooted and grounded in Christ, you'll fall for every doctrine.
Amen.
You'll fall for anything that comes along that sounds good. It sounds good. It sounds like it's really, really good. But let me tell you, the more you know the Word of God, the more you know that, you know what, that's all right. You can go, like, when Jamie and I, you know, we may go to Golden Corral or one of these buffets. There's a lot of things out there that I just don't like. I don't eat. That doesn't mean I have to eat it. That means I choose what I eat. And see, when you know the Word of God, what happens is, and you're strengthened in your inner man, what will happen is you'll know what to eat and what not to eat.
Amen.
Other than that, you're going to go there and you're just going to, it's like, Jamie brought home, we had Kentucky Fried Chicken and coleslaw and stuff last night, and Vinny was all fired up. He was eating that gravy with the potatoes. I said, here, you want to try some coleslaw? He said, yeah, put it in my bag. But see, he knows now what it looks like. He said, I don't like that. Amen? But you're just going to keep eating and eating and eating. Hallelujah. So there's a reason why God gave, Lord, the reason why he gave us apostles and prophets and pastors and teachers, evangelists, and many, many other giftings that are in the body of Christ. See, every one of us in here are very important.
Amen.
We're very important for one another. It's not that you highly esteem me and come down and kiss my ring and love all me and put me on a pedestal. No, the only person you put on a pedestal is Christ Jesus.
Amen.
You may honor my office and what God has called me to do, but you don't bow down to me. Let me tell you,
Amen. It
ain't going to happen. Amen, but we understand what God has called us. There's a reason why he called us. He didn't call everybody to be an evangelist,
nope.
But he called everybody in the ministry.
Yeah. Amen.
He called everybody to be a witness.
That's right.
Called everybody to be a voice to those that are out there in the world because they are lost and they need somebody. Hallelujah. In verse 13 it says, till we all come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, unto the perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. And I've heard people say this over and over and over about our Christian maturity. Say, oh, that's just about what happens when we get to heaven. No, let me tell you, it can happen here.
Amen.
It can happen here. We can be overcomers.
Mm-hmm.
We can be the head and not the tail.
Amen.
It's our choice. Our choice. How much do you want to grow? How much do you want to be in that place? Let me tell you, I didn't come out of my mother's womb preaching like this, did I, Mom? I went through a lot of problems, did I, Mom? I was a sinner, wasn't I, Mom? You ain't got to keep agreeing with everything, Mom. Come on. And she don't know some things that I know, amen? And she knows some things that I don't know, amen? But you know, the thing that ends up being is, it didn't happen that way. Why? Because I was, personally myself, I was diligent about wanting more and 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 more of God.
Amen.
To more to understand him, to love him. Because I want more of what God wants for me. And then it says down here in 14, with all this stuff, listen. The reason why God gave us apostles and prophets and evangelists and pastors and teachers and many other people for protecting the saints. Why? Verse 14. That we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro, carried about by every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. Let me tell you, over this past year, just so far in this past year, just for 2 months, I've seen two or three believers that we were pretty close. Man, let me tell you, they took a long haul on the other side. And I went. Found out after listening to one or two people out there on the internet. And I listen to some of theology and go, oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. Folks, let me tell you, ain't one person in this room has an exception that it's not going to happen to you. What I mean by that is, guess what? The enemy wants to pull you aside. Pull you aside. And I'm telling you, if you want to find anything, you go on the internet, you can look at anything, and you'll find somebody that's preaching what you believe and what you like, and all of a sudden that person will be your spiritual mentor. And next thing you know, you wonder where you got. That's why it says, forsake not the fellowship of your brethren as you see the day approaching. Why? Because iron sharpens iron. Amen? Iron sharpens iron. There's many people in here that sharpen me up. Hallelujah. In verse 15, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. From whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplies according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, it can increase the body unto the edifying of itself in love. Notice that everything that we're going to be talking about is Paul is talking about in all the epistles and even in the other books. You're going to see that love now, all of a sudden, we always talk about love. Amen? We always talk about love. You know, we got all these things up here. And you can walk around and go, oh, I love you. I love you. But do you love somebody with that agape love? Do you love somebody with that immeasurable love that he's poured down? How does that happen? It only happens. You can't do it in your flesh. This flesh cannot love somebody until these things here are accomplished. Remember, this is a progressive thing. It's progressive. You can't go from here to here without repentance and your room clean. It ain't gonna happen. You can't sidestep what God has given us. God talked to Paul, and Paul gave us a key. He said, listen, if you get it, if you really get it, you'll understand, and what happens, you'll have the peace and the love that is immeasurable, beyond what you can even imagine. And you know what? You will be able to talk to somebody that maybe you hated before, that you despised before. Why? Because the love of God has been poured out in you. See, it's automatic. See, if we are strengthened, folks, telling you again over and over, if you're not reading your word, you're missing. Your inner man is growing weak. He's growing weak. The more we read, what happens is, it's very amazing, because what happens now is we go in, we're going to get into some of the scriptures, we're going to see how that applies to other scriptures, and you go, wow, I never saw it that way. Why? Because you start to see that God is trying to get us to a place where we truly can walk in peace. How many here want to walk in total peace? Amen. Amen? Amen? Walk in peace. That no matter what's going on, it doesn't affect you. That when all of a sudden you see on the news that, you know, with the abortion issue or with political issues or this issue, that you just go, amen. And it doesn't bother you. Amen. See, because if it bothers you, listen, if it bothers you, that means your inner man's not strengthened. Or, which means that also there's a few rooms in your house that Jesus wants to clean and you don't want him to get in there. Come on. There's some rooms in your house. There's some rooms that you have and I have right now that we have. Like I said, it's got a nice little pretty bouquet on the front. It's got a nice little pretty, the door's painted nice. And we keep praying for breeze around it. You know, so at least it smells good. Then maybe Jesus, when he comes into the house, he goes, I smell some phony scent.
Amen.
That's what he's going to say. You know, say, I smell something that isn't natural. And what we got to do is we got to open it up and allow him to come in. Folks, pride, all those things, all that stuff is things that in us that we've got to get rid of.
Amen?
Amen? See, he'll work us out, because if we're strong, if we're reading the Word, if we're reading devotions, if we're praying and we're seeking the Lord, and we're truly, see, when we draw nigh to him, he will draw nigh to us.
Yes.
When we draw nigh to him, you have to draw nigh to him. He ain't just going to come and find you. He already found you. He already saved you. He already delivered you. He already brought you back to his Father. He already did that. Now he's saying it's your chance now. It's your time to come and seek out and search after me.
Yeah.
And then once it's clean, then all of a sudden what happens? Remember, he pours out that love. This here is agape love.
Amen.
That's agape love. That's the kind of love that only God can pour out. And when he pours out in you, he also pours that peace. And when you have that peace, that's the peace that surpasses all human understanding. As Jesus said, peace I leave you, not as the world does, but peace I leave you. And that peace is immeasurable peace. And you can walk around in absolute joy. The awesomeness about that is this. Can it happen every day? Yes. Yes. As long as this is being done constantly, guess what? We are walking in peace, and he is going to pour out in you overflowing measure that you can't even imagine. So now think about it. You have the overflowing of God in you. You have love and peace in you. Is there anything that he's going to withhold from you?
Right. No.
No. No. Nothing.
Nothing.
Nothing. He's not going to hold anything back. Why? Because he loves you so much. And he says, you know what? You got it. You got it. Yeah, but I want to go back and still...
No.
You got it. You're not going to want to go back. You're going to want more of him. More of his presence. More of his love. More of his grace. And he continues to pour out. Hallelujah. I want you to turn it over to 1 John chapter 4. We're going to look and see in some of the other scriptures, and we're going to see how this all applies. Hallelujah. Say, Pastor, breathe.
Pastor, breathe.
Hallelujah. 1 John. I'm reading the rest of this stuff is in the Common English Bible, so it may be different than what you know, because this is a very simplistic. And I believe it really brings forth what I believe that God wants to bring forth. 1 John 4, chapter 4, verse 7. Dear friends, let's love each other. Because love is from God. And everyone who loves is born from God and knows God. The person who doesn't love does not know God. Because God is love. So I'm going to tell you that right now. Think about it. You're walking around with bitterness. If you're walking around with selfishness, if you're walking around with pride, if you're walking around with all that, the Bible clearly looks at me and says this, the person who doesn't love does not know God. God loves you. Isn't that amazing? Because the scripture reminds you, pops in my mind is, but Lord, I've cast out demons in your name. Lord, I've done this in your name. Lord, I've done this. Lord, I've done all this. Lord, I've done everything. Lord, I've done all this. And I'm being casted out because Jesus says, I never knew you. I never knew you. Yeah, but I accepted him as Lord and Savior. Yes, I accepted him, but let me tell you something right now. You're back here still maybe in that weak inner man. Still trying to please the outer man.
Amen.
And God's going, hello, I'm here. Do you know what I want to pour out in you? Do you know what I want to do? Do you know if I told you right now what you can do, because I know I've placed it down inside of you. And this is how the love of God is revealed in us. God has sent his only Son into the world so that we can live through him. This is love. It is not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as a sacrifice that deals with our sins. Dear friends, if God loved us this way, we ought to love each other. Bible said that they will know that he was sent because of the love that we have, what? For one another. You know why the church is so fragmented? Because we can't love one another. And the reason we can't love one another is because our inner man is so weak. Because we're worried about trying to look our outer man look so good. Look at me. Look what I can do. Look what I built. Look what I do. Look at all. Look at me. Look at me. Look at me. Pride comes before the fall. Hallelujah. Am I preaching all right today?
Yes, you are. I'm doing pretty good, Jeff.
If God loved us this way, we also to love each other. Verse 12. No one has ever seen God. If you love each other, God remains in us, and his love is made perfect in us. Verse 13. This is how we know we remain in him and how he remains in us. Because he has given us a measure of his Spirit. Amen. We have to learn how to yield to the Spirit of God on a daily basis. Stop yielding to your outer man. Stop yielding to your flesh. Stop yielding to your wants. Stop, stop it. Stop it. Yeah, but Pastor, you know, hey, I'm still working out stuff too, man. Let me tell you, this isn't a one-way thing. You know what? There's three fingers back to me. I know there's things in my life that I've got to change. Because you know what? I want to get over here, folks. I don't know about you, but I want to get over here. Well, you know what? Every day I'm walking in absolute fullness of him.
Amen.
And the more I'm in fullness, the more I'm not worrying about my flesh.
Amen.
And you can walk in peace. You can walk in joy.
Amen?
Amen? Just as Sharon was saying earlier, she says, I'm learning how to say, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus, more and more and more. No matter what the problem is, no matter what the scenario is. Hallelujah. When a tire burst, right, Claude, that's it. Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. How can you do that? Because God's in control. I have absolute peace. The peace that surpasses all human understanding. Hallelujah. Verse 14, we have seen, testify, that the Father has sent the Son to be the Savior of the world.
Yes.
If any of us confess that Jesus is God's Son, God remains in us and we remain in him. Folks, we realize this. There is nothing you can do that can separate you from the love of God.
Amen.
You just might not be able to get from here to here. Does this mean you're saved? Yeah. Does this mean you love the Lord? Yeah. But the more you die to self, and the more we are looking for him to clean our inner room. Oh, man, you know what? I mean, I can't do any of the things of the world. I didn't say any of that. There's stuff you can still do. I've talked about it before. You know what? You want to go boating? You want to go skydiving? You want to go, you want to go, yeah. Don't let that become your idol or your God. God gave us the pleasures of this world.
Amen.
That doesn't mean you have to stop doing it. Yes, you got to be walking around like a monk.
Right.
Then you're no earthly good.
Yes,
amen?
Amen?
But the bottom line is, being is, are you a testimony? You remember, you're an advertisement of God. When somebody looks at you, what do they see?
Right.
Do they truly see the God in you? Or they still see some of that flesh. Do they still see the outer man who's trying so hard to present himself in such a way? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Bear with me, folks. We have known and have believed that the love of God has for us. God is love, and those who remain in God, and God remains in them. This is how love has been perfected in us, so that we can have confidence on the judgment day. Come on now. That we can have what? Confidence on the day of judgment. I don't know about you, but that kind of excites me up. Because we are exactly the same as God is in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear expects punishment. The person who is afraid has not been made perfect in love. We love because God first loved us. If anyone else, I love God, and hates a brother or sister, he is a liar. Because the person who doesn't love a brother or sister who can be seen can't love God who can't be seen. It's some strong words. But these are powerful words. Because see, it all ties in. Do you understand? If we can't love somebody, it's because our inner man is weak. And because our inner man is weak, we have sin in our home, and God can and Jesus cannot be comfortable there anymore. And we are not going to have peace and love, and we're not going to have the fullness of God. So what do? We need to repent. Get back to the basics, folks. We want this. Everybody wants this. But this is the first thing we got to do. You see, we didn't get redemption. We didn't get back to the Father unless Jesus went all the way to the cross. Amen. He had to do something so that we can become children of the Most High God. Wouldn't it be great that Jesus come down, be born, and just die, and everything's fine? No, there had to be a sacrifice for sin. Yeah. See, folks, we got to sacrifice. We got to sacrifice our outer man.
Yes.
So that our inner man can get so strong. And we're in that place where we are absolutely, where Christ is at peace. Every day I walk around, Lord, you happy? Somebody be sitting around me. Man, this guy talking to himself. Lord, you happy? Are you at peace? Lord, is there anything I've said, I thought, something that I did, anything? Lord, show me. Show me so that I can, and you know what? I have peace. Okay, I guess you're happy, Lord. And I have peace. So it means that no matter where I go, I don't care what the person says to me. I don't care how bad it is. I don't care what the scenario is. You know what? I can look at them and say, I love you. I just love you. I was telling somebody this past week, and I want you to listen to what I'm saying. Don't read into what I'm saying. This past week, and I was talking about praying for my brother, my fleshly brother, who is in the hospital, and praying for my best man's daughter, who's going in for a surgery for cancer. And I said to them, I said, I love them both the same.
Amen.
And they looked at you. Yeah, he's my brother, and she's my sister. I love them both the same. I don't love my brother any more than I love Dana.
Amen.
See, when we get to the point that, you know what, I love Jamie just as much as I love Dee. I have a different relationship with Jamie, but it's the same thing. Just like I love Mom. It don't matter. See, do you love one another? That's love. That's agape love. And that doesn't happen. That does not happen. It's not by balloons. Hey, I'm going to give you a balloon and say, hey, I love you. That's a great our man thing. Amen.
Let it go.
How are you going to show it? It's because I prefer you more than me. I prefer you more than me. Doesn't matter. Glenn, I love you more than you can even imagine. And I may see you maybe once every... And when I see you. Amen. It doesn't matter. See, the same love that I have for him right here, same love I have for Dee. Same love I have for Dawn. There's no difference in love. And that love is not, it's not an outer man love. It's an inner man love, because you just love people. And all of a sudden, God starts to do some things. And when he starts opening some doors, and you know what? People around on the outside go, oh, well, he's, you know, whatever. Amen. Praise the Lord. Doesn't affect me. Because those people don't know where I'm at, where I'm at, and where you're at.
Yes,
see, you're at a place right now. God's growing us up. God's growing us up in love. God's growing us up so that we become so strong that when that telephone call comes, that you don't panic. That you just go, thank you, Lord.
Amen.
And you just go in your prayer room. Say, thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. How do we know more about love? If you turn to 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3. Hallelujah. Try to get through this real quick here. 1 John chapter 3, verse 16. This is how we know love. And Jesus laid down his life for us. And we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. Skip had shared this morning. That's a powerful scripture. Remember, does it mean that you got to lay down your life physically? Maybe have to lay down your outer man.
Amen.
Maybe have to come to a realization that, you know what? Are you willing to stop what you're doing? Come on now. Are you willing to stop what you're doing? What your plans are? What your agenda may be? So that you can help somebody else out. That's laying your life down. That's laying your life down. See, so many times what happens, we all have our own agendas. Amen? We all have our own agendas. But what is God? See, endeavor to guard the unity in the spirit upon the peace. I know one of the things that God continues to show me over and over and over in my life is that I'm coming to a point right now where I get more pleasure watching somebody else exceed and excel in them than me doing anything. Man, it just blows me away. When Carly came in today with the new flyer and everything, I mean, I'm fired up. Amen. I'm fired up. Why? It's because God's moving in her life. You know, when you see people just jumping out and doing things, all of a sudden, it's like, man, let me tell you, I'll jump over barrels and stand in front and protect. But man, we got to be walking in unity. When we're walking in unity, God is going to, it's going to blow you away, folks. Blow you away. In verse 16. This is how verse 17. But if a person has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need, and that person doesn't care, how can the love of God remain in him? Little children, let's not love with words or speech, but with actions and truth. This is how we will know that we belong to the truth. And reassure our hearts in God's presence. Even if our hearts condemn us, God is greater than our hearts and knows all things. Dear friends, if our hearts don't condemn us, we have confidence in relationship to God. Hallelujah. Dear friends, if our hearts don't condemn us, we have confidence in relationship to God. That means we have peace. That means we have joy. That means we're in a place. You know what? I'm telling you, so many times what happens is we are not yielding to the Spirit of God. We're still trying to feed the outer man. How can we feed the outer man? We try to do everything that we can because we say, Years ago, and I shared this, and I'm going to bring it back up again, I did a whole research and started looking at the Crusades, the early Crusades in the 1600s. And they all had on these big, beautiful white robes with big crosses on them. I'm doing it for Christ. And they traveled in teams of people, slaughtering and stealing, raping women, killing people, across Europe. to get to Jerusalem to bring the goods and say, we did it all for Christ. Isn't that happening today? Same things happen today. We're pillaging, raping. We're not doing it physically, but we're doing it with our mouths. We're doing it with our actions. We're doing it in a way that, hey, I'm doing it for Christ.
Amen.
Yeah, but did God tell you?
Yeah.
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
God didn't tell you, but stop it.
That's right.
Because what you're doing is you're bringing confusion and you're bringing strife into the body of Christ.
Amen.
Last thing, I want you to go over to 1 Corinthians. Hallelujah. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1 and 8. If I speak in tongues of human beings and of angels, but I don't have love, I am clanging gong or a clashing cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy, and I know all the mysteries and everything else, and if I have such complete faith that I can move mountains, but I don't have love, I'm nothing. If I give away everything that I have and hand over my body to feel good about what I've done, but I don't have love, I receive no benefit whatsoever.
Amen.
See, that's the outer man. The inner man, love is patient. Love is kind. It isn't jealous. It doesn't brag. It isn't arrogant. It isn't rude. It doesn't seek its own advantage. It isn't irritable. And it doesn't keep a record of complaints. It isn't happy with injustice. And it is happy with the truth. Love puts up with all things. Trusts in all things. Hopes for all things. Endures all things. Love never fails. In that, you have peace. Peace that surpasses all human understanding. So we start to see in the scriptures how this love is different than many times that we thought about it before. Hallelujah. One last scripture and we're calling them coming in for a landing. Amen?
Amen.
Galatians chapter 5. Verse 16. I say, be guided by the Spirit, and you won't carry out your selfish desires. A person's selfish desires are set against the Spirit.
Yes.
And the Spirit is set against one's selfish desires. They are opposed to each other. So if they're opposed to each other, whoever is the strongest is going to win. If your inner man is stronger than your outer man, you're going to be at peace and you'll be able to walk in the Spirit. And you won't fulfill the lusts of the flesh. But if you are being led by the Spirit, you aren't under the law. The actions that are produced by selfish motives, the outer man are obvious. Since they include sexual immorality, moral corruption, doing whatsoever feels good, idolatry, drug use, casting spells, hate, fighting, obsession, losing your temper, competitive opposition, conflict, selfishness, group rivalry, jealousy, drunkenness, partying, and other things like that. I warn you, as I have already warned you, that those who do these things, these kinds of things, won't inherit God's kingdom.
Amen.
Amen.
That's big.
But when we're over here, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. I have a book that I've been reading and I keep reading over and over and over. I got it many, many, many years ago. It was written by a woman by the name of Wendy Alec. She received a visitation from the Lord back in November of 1999. And she wrote down what she felt the Lord was giving her. I'll tell you, it's a very, very powerful book. And I want to finish out today by reading something. Oh, I grieve as I look to my church in this day. For as my eyes pass to and fro across the earth, I see my church caught up not in things that count for eternity, but so ensnared and entangled in the temporal things of the world system. For indeed the evil one has infiltrated the church in this past hour. And my sons and my daughters have become ensnared with the pride of life. Indeed, it is the pride of life that keeps my ministers from entering into everything destined and ordained for them. For too often my children's treasures are treasures of brick and of mortar and of their possessions. And I see the hearts of my ministers ensnared with their building programs and their activities of ministry. My heart grieves, for their heart is based upon the things that fade away and the things that do not come from the Father, but come from the world itself. For where their treasure is, so indeed will their heart be. Yes, I hear you say, minister, no, my heart is not so. And I would say to you, my building is not made of bricks and mortar, son. But you have taken much stock of your building when my people have been passed over. But I tell you that the cry of every and smallest of these has not passed unnoticed by my Father. Oh, for you have business programs and you teach your men to invest and plan, and to plan, and that is good, and it is beneficial. But as I pass by the congregations, I see each man use his faith for his own, for his house, his car, his stocks, and his shares, for the finest. And surely I say unto you, minister, take heed and teach your people, for my prosperity is a prosperity to bless the poor and the lame, to feed the third world nations, to send my missionaries to help those less fortunate. But you see, the pride of life teaches my people to despise the lesser, and they pat themselves on the head. They mix only in the circles of prosperity, and in their heart they despise these lesser ones. But I tell you, these same ones who have placed their treasures in things that fade shall perish with those not of my house, as my judgment comes to the world system. For they shall reap the just reward of the pride of life. And so it shall be that the same stocks and shares that caused them such rejoicing and caused such an elitist spirit, shall cause them to weep. And they shall weep and wail on the day of judgment on the monetary systems of this world. And they sit in your congregations, O minister of the gospel. They are your elders, O minister of the gospel. They are your boards, O minister of the gospel. They are your lunch and dinner companions, O minister of the gospel. I tell you, warn them that they may repent. Warn them to humble themselves under the mighty hand, that I may have yet mercy upon them. For I come not for the righteous, or for the self-sufficient ones. The very ones that these despise in their heart are the very little ones that my Father sent me to pour out my life blooded for. These are the ones they so despise. But for those who have been faithful to my Father in the monetary matters of the earth, to those who have not set their heart upon the possessions and the riches that I have blessed them with, but have laid up their treasures in heaven and have given of my substance to feed the poor and those of lesser fortune than themselves. For those who have poured out my substance through their vehicles that I have raised up to preach the gospel in these end times and have given of their substance generously and joyfully with a thankful heart, to these ones comes a multiplication a multiplication not as in the past, for in the past it was a multiplication of fives and tens. But in the coming time, says the Lord, I will multiply my substance supernaturally. Upon these ones that it has shared be 100 and 1,000-fold. And I shall yet open up unseen riches that until now have been hidden in the secret places of earth. And to these ones I shall pour out them the old of Ophan and the treasures of Solomon. I shall pour upon them the gold hidden deep under the earth and the oil shall come into their hands. These will not have to tremble when my judgment falls, for I shall keep their substance safe in the eye of the storm. For their substance is indeed my substance, and their inheritance is my inheritance. For they are the proven ones, the ones whose treasure is fixed on me. And as it closes, and so in these latter days you shall see them come forth as guiding lights, rising not from within the world system, but rising out of the world system. Yes, they shall rise. Watch now and see if they will not come forth. And through them my ministers shall be blessed and shall do their exploits, and through their faithfulness in the hidden places. So my gospel shall be financed and shall be preached throughout all the nations of the earth. So shall it be. Amen. It's a powerful prophetic word. And I believe that God really, truly, truly, truly wants to pour. I believe that God's showing us some keys to help us not to operate as the church has operated for years, but to operate as He wants to operate and do what He wants to do. See, for so many years we try to show the world, hey, look what I've got. This is my success. No, the greatest riches you have is your inner man so strong that you can do many exploits because He's going to do it through you.
Amen?
Amen. Amen. Won't you stand to your feet? Hallelujah. I want you to hold up somebody next to you. Hold their hand.
Got it?
Yeah.
I don't want to push you.
Give me time.
I know this morning there's many different levels of faith in this room this morning. And I encourage you, God will reveal to you that which you needed today. Don't worry about trying to remember everything. It ain't going to happen. But God knows what you need right now at this moment. Where are you up here? Is your inner man so weak that you're still being controlled by the outer man, the lust of the flesh, addictions, situations that are going on? Because you're trying to resolve the problem by the outer man's solutions. Christ died and Christ delivered you. If you're a believer today and you're still dealing with the outer man is so strong, it's because you're not reading, you're not seeking the Lord, you're not in prayer, you're not in fellowship, you're not doing those things which will continue to feed your inner man. Can you imagine, as we have this luncheon today, that you don't eat for the rest of the week until next Sunday, how weak your body is going to be? You can't do it. I'm telling you. You can't. It just ain't going to happen. It ain't going to happen. You need to feed yourself every day. If you need help in that, please see one of the ministers. See Carla or Skip or John or myself, or anybody. Talk to them, or Kevin and Dee. Talk to them. How can I, I'm struggling with this. We'll figure out a way so that we can get you fed. Get you fed. You need to be fed. Because the outer man wants nothing more but to live. Father God, today, Lord, as we show our love, Lord, today to the children and to the churches in Salem County by the act that we're about to do. Lord, we do it not, Lord God, to get a name. Lord, we do it not to, Lord God, to say, hey, look at the River Church. I could care less. I want them to see Jesus. I want people to understand that it's Jesus. A church can't save you. A pastor can't save you. But Jesus can. Jesus can deliver you. Jesus can heal you. Jesus can set you free. And then we come to our house. Maybe today there's some things that the Spirit of God is already speaking to your heart about. You don't have to confess it to me. You need to confess it to Jesus. The altar will be open. You can come up. You can do it right there. Right there in your seat. There's things that you know in your heart that you know are wrong. Maybe you don't know it's wrong. Ask the Lord, He'll tell you. Build a greater relationship with Him. Talk to Him every moment of the day. You just say, thank you, Jesus. Just say, I love you, Lord. Just constantly, the more you do that, the more and more you'll understand and you'll start to see the presence of God around you. Acknowledge Him for who He is. And as you continue to grow, He's going to give you that love, that agape love, that only He can give. You can't get the love off of me or off of anyone in here. That's a love that only He can give you. And it's an immeasurable supernatural love. As we come into this week of Valentine's Day, that people will buy and spend fortunes to show somebody's love. And that all is nothing but vanity. The greatest love that we can have is to show the love of God that's in us to someone else. Father, thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you, Lord, for how you're changing and molding and cracking and shaping us into the image of Jesus Christ. And Father, I thank you today, Lord. Father, I thank you for each and every one in this room because, Lord, they're very, very special, Lord. Not only, Lord God, to this ecclesia, but they're also very special to you. Lord, each and every one of us is the apple of your eye. You care for us so much, and you love us so much. So, Father, Lord God, I ask you to bless each and every one here. That, Lord, every word that they needed to hear that would be rooted and solidified in their heart. That the enemy, Lord, will not come as the birds and pick it away. Or, Lord God, as they hear it and they get excited about it, but, Lord God, the enemy in the world steals it. But that, Father, Lord God, it is rooted and grounded in good soil, and that it will produce much fruit. Father, bless the rest of this day, Lord God, as we fellowship, as we share with one another, and Lord God, as we eat and break bread together. Father, we ask you, Lord God, as we come and as we give of our tithes, our offerings, Lord God. Father, Lord, it's the first day of the week. Lord, we've come here today because it is the first day of the week. And that, Lord God, we come as our first fruits and give unto you. So, Father, we thank you, Lord, that you would bless us abundantly more than we could ask or think of. Pressed down, shaken together, running over. And, Father, we bless you, Lord, for this beautiful day that you've given us. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 If everybody...